Today, all over the world, ships and men of the United States Coast Guard are in action side by side with the Army, Navy, and the Marines. This war of unparalleled ferocity and scope has imposed new problems upon the Coast Guard, greater, tougher problems than ever before. Because global war for the United States means global duty for the Coast Guard. With vastly expanded forces engaged in extremely complex operations, the training and courage of officers and men of the Coast Guard is put to vital test. In all theaters of war, officers now in action have been schooled at the Coast Guard Academy in New London, Connecticut, where today are being prepared the officers of tomorrow. Prepared to carry on a tradition 150 years old. Here at the Academy are combined the lore of the sea with the technical education of an officer. Here, heads are made wise and bodies strong for the variety of responsibilities which the Coast Guard faces in peace and in war. In peacetime, the Coast Guard has among its many functions the maintenance of an Arctic patrol, linking us with northern outposts and providing bases to protect our shipping routes, our lines of ocean communication and supply. In these remote places, the native inhabitants have come to rely on the Coast Guardsmen for the enforcement of law and the distribution of medicine and food in case of emergency. After the sinking of the Titanic in the North Atlantic in 1912, the Coast Guard was designated by the nations of the world to maintain the International Ice Patrol of Northern Waters. And so effective has been this service that in three decades, not one single ship has been lost through iceberg collision. At sea and in the air, the Coast Guard maintains along the shores of the United States a tightly coordinated system of patrol craft. Of incalculable value to shipping also is a chain of hundreds of lighthouses and lightships. Essential to the commerce which moves on America's inland waterways is the supervision and activity of the Coast Guard, which polices and patrols the rivers which are so vital to the nation's economy. No less important are the shipping lanes of the Great Lakes, which must be kept free of ice, thus releasing millions of tons of raw material to centers of industry and finished products to seaports for shipment abroad. Best known to most people, however, is the work of the hundreds of Coast Guard lifeboat stations, which are located strategically along the continental shorelines. From these vantage points, Coast Guardsmen must be always on the alert to give aid to men and ships in distress in any weather. A vast fortune in shipping and thousands of lives have been saved by their vigilance. But also in wartime, from the early days of the founding of our country to the latest world conflicts, Coast Guard ships have distinguished themselves. Since the outbreak of this war, the peacetime strength of the Coast Guard has increased tenfold, and a multitude of new and hazardous tasks have been added to its regular duties. Convoys must be protected from marauders of the sea and air. Troops have to be transported over thousands of ocean miles to remote islands and distant battlefronts. But the final test of the Coast Guard's training and combat efficiency comes with the landing operation itself, when Coast Guardsmen carry the fighting soldiers and Marines from ship to shore. At At the Academy in New London, the peace and wartime demands made upon the Coast Guard are anticipated. For these demands, hundreds of trained officers are necessary. New cadets are selected by competitive examinations throughout the country. Minimum education, high school. Minimum age, 17. Minimum health, perfection. The administration of the Oath of Allegiance marks the formal beginning of the 3-year training period for the new cadet. To be a cadet, he must look like one. Uniformity of appearance and bearing are the first obligations imposed upon him. After receiving his equipment, everything he can conceivably need, from handkerchiefs to a rifle, getting settled and accustomed to his new life becomes his first problem. But for a man of his age, adjustment is easy to acquire. Tidiness of dress and living quarters must become habitual. He has to be a persuasive example to the men he will ultimately lead. The Cadet Corps is officered and staffed by upperclassmen under the supervision of commissioned officers. So if the swab, as new cadets are called, is nervous before the discriminating eye of his critics, in a couple of years, he himself may be the critic of a fresh class of swabs, with the same exacting standards. Homesickness and passing moods of depression are natural for the young cadet so recently separated from his family. For these moments of small distress, the Academy Chaplain's office is his port of emergency. Here, his personal problems can be aired in private, and he will receive a sympathy which has been deepened through many generations of cadets. Now the new man is assigned to his permanent company. With these men, he will march and learn, work and play. They are his comrades for the years ahead. Because later in service, he must meet both emergencies and routine, the cadet's training in practical seamanship is thorough and many-sided. He must know the pulling of small boats, in addition to the handling of craft by sail. Soon, not long following his discovery of the difference between the bow and the stern of the boat, sailing has become an agreeable part of the cadet's routine. Certainly no less fun because required. Especially when, after some skill has been mastered, the cadets compete with neighboring college crews in races on the Thames. Always and foremost, the Coast Guard is a military organization. This means drill and discipline, practice and repetition. But it also means, for the future officer, mastering the time-honored customs of field and parade etiquette. Heading a highly diversified training program is the superintendent of the academy, who functions as a college president and military leader. In this double role, it is the admiral's responsibility to keep his staff abreast of ever-changing maritime problems and modern scientific developments. In addition to its specializations, the academy has a well-rounded curriculum. It is an accredited American college and awards a Bachelor of Science degree to the graduating cadet. Proper attention is given to languages and literature, history, maritime economics, and law. great stress is laid upon the modern sciences, particularly those having a practical bearing on engineering, seamanship, and navigation. Here in the classroom are explained the fundamental principles of physics, such as aerodynamics as applied to ships and planes. As future duty may carry the officer all over the world, his range of information is expected to be wide and up to date. The mysteries of the chemical elements are explained as carefully to the student as the mystery of the elements of the weather. In order to master the art of gunnery, the cadet must learn all the modern complexities of the mechanisms and principles of naval guns. But it takes more than theory to make an engineer. In the steam laboratory, classroom work is amplified by first-hand contact with engines. Heavy emphasis, of course, is laid upon mathematics, the language of science and engineering. Most interesting of all, perhaps, are the lessons the cadet is taught during the summer term aboard ship. Here, under typical seagoing conditions, the student performs every duty which regular routine or emergency may subsequently require him to assume. Here, whatever the weather, whatever the hour, he will take his turn in performing his manifold duties. Here he will discover that he can put to practical advantage his knowledge of how bearings are taken and a compass used. On the ship, he will apply his classroom theories of navigation and seamanship and appreciate the value of the book knowledge, which may have occasionally seemed dry. Here, with an ocean ahead and below, he comes to realize that a ship's officer must know not only where he is going, but precisely how to get there. For the strenuous life of training and duty ahead, the cadet must keep himself in first-class physical trim. Calisthenics are balanced with competitive sports to guarantee perfect health. Football is the favorite sport at the academy, as it is up and down America. The team at New London plays a tough schedule every fall, and its roster of games furnishes a season of excitement and suspense for the whole school. Another aspect of the life at the academy is its social side. Among these occasions are informal hours when cadets are welcomed to the homes of the officers. Because of their informality, these afternoons contribute considerably to the young cadet's poise. Biggest of the many social events at the academy is the annual fall dance. This occasion gives the cadets a chance both to relax from constant study and to enjoy the company of guests and each other on an entirely social basis. On the night of the fall dance, all problems of study are put aside briefly in the interests of sheer pleasure. Most of the time, though, the cadets are satisfied with more informal entertainment. The recreation hall is a favorite gathering place for them to relax and smoke, exchange ideas and experiences, and prepare for the new phases of instruction lying ahead. Aviation is now a regular part of cadet education because a vastly enlarged Coast Guard has military and naval obligations compelling wider use of the airplane. Where formerly the Coast Guard employed planes only for routine patrols, now they are an indispensable aid to shipping and a weapon against attack. With the expansion of the Coast Guard air arm, it is necessary for the cadet to be familiar with aviation principles and have some experience in the sky. After a period of sea duty as a commissioned officer, those who qualify can take intensive training in this branch of the service. Alert to fresh developments, the Academy inaugurated courses in invasion tactics early in the war. Among the Coast Guard officers landing the troops in practically every invasion are New London graduates. The handling of various types of invasion craft is taught during the summer term, both as theory and practice. Of equal importance is rifle and pistol instruction, as Coast Guardsmen are charged with the security of every American port. And in landing operations, effective use of small arms may determine life or death. Just as serious, but more strenuous, are the commando maneuvers which the Pacific War experience proved so necessary. Here, the strength and agility learned on the obstacle course is applied in deadly earnest. All that remains for the cadet is to prove his knowledge. He must show his understanding of everything he has been taught. He has been given every opportunity to qualify: time, study, and individual attention. Final examinations, for which he has prepared feverishly, determine the cadet's career and future life. Passing grades mean his final eligibility for both his degree and his commission. At New London, the graduation ceremonies are preceded by full regimental review. 3 years of almost daily drill on the parade ground now has its reward in proudly perfect performance, in unerring formations. This, his last day at the Academy after 3 years as a cadet, he is taking away with him more than a Bachelor of Science diploma and an ensign's commission. He is taking away a liberal education and a disciplined mind. He is ready to lead men and to take his place beside his fellow officers. Wherever his first assignment may take the full-fledged officer, he will have to shoulder new and serious responsibilities. Yet, whether his country is at war or at peace, he will execute his multitude of duties efficiently, unflinchingly. For upon the unselfish devotion of such men has been built the history and traditions of the United States Coast Guard.